First question, tell me if you can see me, someone. Give me a thumbs up, give me a fire, give me a something, anything. Am I seen? Volume up, but you can see me. How's that? Better? Hello, hey now. Good, 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 good. Yes, no, maybe? Perfecto, I like it. All right, wrong sound effect. I'm just learning how to do this. So, hey, everybody, welcome to No Filter Network. Welcome to the Bleacher Brother Midweek Sports Update. Someone needs to teach me how to get this chat out of my face. It's covering the whole thing, but not tonight. I will just put my co-host in charge of that chat, and my co-host is going to be joining us here momentarily. Here comes Rockin' Reese is coming on. Big show tonight. We've got quite a few guests. I am. Did that intro that I played, did anybody see that actual intro? Was that, Reese, did you see that?
I did.
All right. How'd it look?
All right. Looked good.
Good, good, good. Cool. You excited? We're on the show?
Yes, I am. Thanks for having me, first and foremost.
And, oh, man. Are you kidding me?
I love being on here. little nervous. It's the first time in front of a new audience, but I'm sure that'll pass by in like no time.
That's all right. They are they're gonna love you, man, and they're gonna love Captain Ron tomorrow night on the last call. So you ever hear that expression, the show must go on? I guess that's a show business. Like, technically, we are in show business now, right?
Yeah,
we're big time entertainers, and so I don't understand why. People text me while they know I'm doing this with stupid fucking questions they should have asked me like for the last week leading up to this. What's the name of the show? I don't know, idiot. Forget it. Don't come on the show tonight. We're good without you. But anyway, the show must go on. And honestly, dude, this is like the worst day of my life. So you ever wake up and you're just out of sync?
Yeah, I've had them days.
Yeah, so I had a meeting yesterday on the other side of the state, so it's about a three-hour drive there, a three-hour drive back, and I don't handle the driving so good anymore, but I did it, and I was exhausted, but the meeting that I had on the other side of the state was, you know, friends, but it was somewhat business, and it went really well, so then I got into bed last night. I'm ready to just kick it and chill and watch a little TV and pass out. I slept for about 3 hours, woke up, all my wheels are spinning about this show, about what we're going to do, all these different things that we're doing. I could not sleep at all. So I stayed up since 3:30, thought I was good, and then brain fog all day. Everything went wrong. Everything that could possibly irritate me happened to me today. Every single slow driver, every school bus, every person that could piss me off, things that were supposed to be ready, things that were good to go, just nothing at all went my way. I literally went home also because I got this insane back pain out of nowhere because I've been working out like a beast all year. Look at me. See my shirt? Look at this. Everything hurts. Can you see that? You see that? Literally everything does hurt. But my back was killing me so bad today. I went home at 1 o'clock and took a nap like a little school kid. But I sucked it up and the show must go on. So here we are. Hey, couple things real quick before we bring our first guest on. Did you see what Aaron Judge did today?
Yeah, let's see. 55th home run, fourth straight game in a row. Yeah.
Yeah.
Plus the Yankees like finally won that game, I believe, in 11.
I'm not even watching what the Yankees do. I'm just watching what Judge does. Yeah. That's all. And just, hey, yeah. I got to put him on the spot. One of our watchers, listeners here, Duncan Dad, he said, I believe Judge would not get to 60 home runs. It's a doubleheader. Judge could be at 60 home runs by the end of the night. You know what I mean? If he hits five in the last game.
Yeah, well, he's got a couple weeks to do it. So.
And what was it? Did you see that shit with Baltimore last night?
Oh, yeah. And actually, I just sent it to you to your Facebook a little while ago, but before we went on the air.
I didn't see it. I'm sorry.
I mean, my God, who would have thought Baltimore of all teams would get into a fight?
Dude, and they're driving. I mean, what are they? They're a couple games out of the wild card spot.
Both them and Toronto are.
Yeah, and the fight, was with Toronto, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, I would not mess with anybody with Vlad Jr. on that team because he can buy probably an entire roster.
I still don't want to even mess with his pops. His pops is thinking of 60s or 70s right now.
Yeah, he's probably about the same age as Albert Pujols right now. And Pujols, he hit another one, I think, yesterday or the day before.
Yep.
So he's creeping up, isn't he?
I think he's like 695 right now.
Maybe. Yeah, he's did he tie A-Rod or he's one behind A-Rod?
I think he's one behind.
Come on, Reese. We're running a sports show here. We should know these things. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but I also got to remember because they're also playing right now.
Yeah, I literally also tonight, Reese. I got notes. I got outlines and notes, and I just don't know how many home runs Pujols has or Aaron Judge has. Reese, do me a favor also. Keep an eye on the chat, all right? Because I am trying to walk and chew gum and not complain about my back hurting, and I already blew that. So if you can keep an eye on the chat, if there's something good, let me know, and we'll, somebody says something clever. Obviously, Duncan Dad, who I love and supports us, but... Yeah. You know, he's got no credibility after saying that Aaron Judge would not get anywhere close to, I think he said Judge would actually end up at 60 on the button or just below it. But anyway,
Pujols is one behind A-Rod.
One behind A-Rod. Okay. For those of you keeping score out in the scorekeeper's land. And how about the big news with the, first of all, Met fans woke up this morning tied for first place with the Atlanta Braves.
And then it took a little longer than I thought it was going to happen. Hours
after waking up, their top pitcher on the disabled list.
Yeah, talk about a 1-2 punch of bad news.
Yeah, it's all over for them. So, anyway, we got a big show. We're going to get going here. Hey, my first guest, Ted. There's a button down bottom left-hand corner of your computer screen. It says knock. Hit that sucker, and that's what I'm going to do to bring you. There you go. Okay, I see. I'm going to bring you on in 1 second. Everybody that's new here, and I saw that we actually had a lot of reservations for tonight, so that's awesome. Thank you for watching. Welcome to No Filter. No Filter is to podcasting what Sirius Satellite and XM were 20 years ago. It was small. It was just starting out, but this thing is going to explode. No Filter made a huge announcement today that hosting now is free. Anyone can get on. If you want to produce content, you want to get on the air, it's absolutely free. And No Filter, after tonight's show, if you want to browse around at the other hosts that are on the show or that are on the channel, I mean, there are some absolutely fantastic shows and some personalities and people that you may want to see. We've got just a few right there. Tony Bruno show every Friday night, 7 o'clock. Guy is insane. He's off the chain. He's one of the guys that I grew up listening to. And even now, where he could be just kind of lounging on his boat and fishing and chilling all day, the guy has got the drive and motivation to put on show after show after show. And every week, the show gets better and better and better. Definitely check out the Into the Night show with Tony Bruno on Friday nights at 7 o'clock. Also, Duncan Dad runs a show, the after show. It's the Into the Nightcap show with Duncan and a few other guys where... It's a really chill, but it's a really cool show. Check that out. Duncan Dad does a few shows during the week also. And then names that you may know, and also a friend of ours, Stephen Luker, does some retro shows, which are pretty cool. If you're into old retro TV commercial shows, he does these great shows. You can search the host by name. You can browse. You got Will the Thrill Clark is on here. Sean Salisbury, Sean Casey, Nick Swisher has a channel on here. Kevin Euclid for you Red Sox fans out there. Jeremy Roenick. Eric Burns, the list goes on and on and on. So anyway, the way No Filter works, you got a chat button down at the bottom. It says chat on it, I believe. You can click that chat button and you can talk to us. You can talk to other people in the chat room. We'll try to get to your comments and questions if we can. And that is it. Just kind of sit back, relax, and enjoy. So I'm going to bring my first guest on, okay? Because what I wanted to do is... so he should be popping on here in a minute. This guy's name is Ted Brooks. I've known this guy for quite a long time. And he's got a company called The Sports Profits. These guys are money. I am not a big college basketball or football fan. I'm sorry, at all. There he is. How you doing, buddy? You hear me?
We can.
We can't hear you. He's a mime, but that's all right. He's going to tell us right through miming. And he's got the game. Is that the Philly game on in the background? I see a Philly shirt back there. He figures his sound out real quick. Let me tell you, he's got a company called The Sports Profits. I've been tracking these guys for years, and these guys are extremely high percentage winners. And that's what he does. He's a handicapper. This guy started back in the early 2000s with... Started back in the days of like, I don't even remember, when just poker was all over there. The Poker Palace and remember that, somebody Party Poker, yeah, that's what it was. And where'd you go? You went down to like Costa Rica or somewhere, didn't you? And you were kind of rocking it out down there with all this?
Costa Rica, used to live all over Florida. Can you guys hear and see me good before we get rolling?
Yeah, your volume's a little low. I'm going to try... to see if I can bring you up on my end. We'll see. I got this fancy equipment now, man. I am literally, but I don't know how to work it. That's the problem. But I'm going to try to bring you up. So go ahead. So tell us. Here's where I got you. You're the man.
Yeah.
High percentages. So, you were in Costa Rica starting out. Tell us your story and teach me, because I know nothing about college football, but I do like to win some money. So... I'm going to turn it over to you, buddy.
I'll give you awesome. Thank you so much, AJ. Appreciate being on here. I never even heard about, before I get into myself or anything, I never even heard about No Filter until you told me about it. And it's pretty great. I mean, so far, so good. Can you guys hear me clear?
Yeah, I can hear you. Everybody else, chat room, Reese, yeah?
I can hear you.
All right.
So No Filter looks amazing, first of all, and I think I might want to start my own show on it. So... But I started in the online gambling world doing poker, doing blackjack, whatever I could. Me, bunch of my buddies, we used to rack up in one room, get on a Wi-Fi and just crush the tables. And then I started to see that you could make a lot more money and be a lot more consistent with sports betting. But even in my own foray into doing it, at first I wasn't a winner. At first I wasn't really making it happen. And then I kind of, everything clicked and I realized, well, you know, in the world of poker, you're by yourself. You can't have somebody come up to the table, tell you something in your ear. You can't have assistance. You can't use electronic devices. But in the world of sports betting, you could do whatever you want. You could call whoever you want. You could pay whoever you want. You can reach out to whoever you want. You can get advice from whoever you want. So it's not so much about me. and you use the word handicapper. I hate the word handicapper, but most people don't.
Sorry, man. I grew up at the racetrack, so that's a racetrack word. And
well, it's a sports betting word too, but what I am more of, I consider myself an information gatherer. So I use sources. I use other handicappers, friends, colleagues, people in the industry, and it's more of a collective. So what I do is collect information from different places and bring it all together. So I have a team of handicappers. I have guys underneath me that are working for me and then delivering me that information. But I don't like talking about myself. What I will say is this, on YouTube in 2021, this year, we're around 60, 62%, but in 2021 is something I was very proud of. On free YouTube games, we went 67%. We went...
What are free YouTube games? What are free YouTube games?
So, great question. So, I have a YouTube channel. If you, I think I sent you the link, AJ. And about 5 to 6 times a week, I release a game. I break down a game against the spread. I break down a game money line sometimes, sometimes a total. And we do it for free. We put it out there. And it's for anyone who wants to watch it. And in 2021, on those games, 67%. Now, I'm not telling anyone to bet $1,000 a piece on my YouTube games. But if you bet $1,000 a piece on the YouTube games in 2021, you would have made about $60,000. Wins minus losses, including the juice on the games.
That's pretty damn good.
I have a lot to cover. I know you're not a sports betting channel, and I just have so much...
I wanted someone to come on and do this, and you know, you're the first guy I thought of, so... And after I announced you, FYI, on Twitter, I had 5 sports betting people. Everybody claims to be good. And I turned a couple down and just ignored the rest because I know what you're capable of. So teach me. I'm going to bet on some NCAA football this weekend. And I know where people that you know live. So if you give me those free bets that don't work out, I'm going to send Reese around to collect my livings.
We have 5 college football games I'm going to break down today. Before I get into that, I want to talk about baseball, betting baseball for 1 second. And you're a baseball guy.
Oh, I love it.
So
I dig that you have the Phillies on for me.
The Phillies and the Marlins, your team and my team, right?
I like it.
So, you know, the sticky stuff, talking about bullpens. I am a very... Most people won't tell you this. I have been getting crushed in baseball since they made these pitching rule changes. The only baseball that I've been successful with in the last 2 years is first 5 innings because the bullpens are absolutely unpredictable ever since they made all these rule changes with the sticky stuff going up to the pitcher in the middle of the game, checking his glove and everything. It has made significant changes. You see the scores. You see the over-unders. You see baseball scores 21-7. That's a football score, not a baseball score. So one thing, just touching on baseball before I get into college football, first 5 innings is where I've been finding the success for the last couple of years. So anybody, you guys out there betting baseball, finding that you're finding these pitching matchups that seem good, but then all of a sudden they go south, to me, stick with the first 5 inning and you'll get a lot more success. So that's my baseball betting tip of the day. And I guess you want me to get into these college football games next, right?
Yeah, let it rip. I know nothing. Teach me. Okay. Teach me, because if I go out there, I'm going to lose my money.
So before I get into my breakdown games, I'm going to go over some things that newbies in college football betting and just football betting in general, they succumb to and not to succumb to. Number one, don't be afraid to buy the point or buy the half a point. Do you know what that means, AJ, Maurice?
I mean, you're talking about like with teasers, yes or no?
I'm talking about this first game I'll get into here. We're going with the UCF Knights versus the Louisville Cardinals. Full disclosure, I went to UCF, so I do have a little bit of a bias with this team. But they've been
good night.
They've been a great team for the last few years. They had that 25-game run with Scott Frost before he went to Nebraska.
Oh, I got to say something when it comes to the Knights real quick. A couple years ago when y'all had that undefeated season, I got so pissed off with the NCAA because I'm like, let me get this bullshit straight. We have Georgia and Bama, both one-loss teams. They're in the championship. Both got beat by Auburn. But then Auburn just gets beat by the Knights, who were undefeated.
We're national champions, baby. We're national champions, as far as I'm concerned. They actually declared themselves national champions, if you saw that. But yeah, the Scott Frost era was very good. He's in Nebraska now, getting crushed. I feel bad for the guy. He should have never left.
That's what you did for leaving.
Should have never left. But let me get into this game. So UCF Louisville. I'll do some against this, but let me say this about college betting and why I like it. In football, NFL versus college football programs matter way more. History matters way more. Trends matter more. In NFL, you have professionals. They come out there every day to do their job, and last year is not this year. Whereas in college football, you rely on crowd a lot more. You rely on there's certain games that a coach knows how to get his team up for that game. And when you can track that and you can find those games and find those trends, it's a lot easier to make money in college football, for me at least, in my history, than NFL. The spread, the second game that we're doing, which is the Bama Texas game, I'll talk about this a little bit more. But the spread matters for college football teams. Margin of victory doesn't matter in the NFL. It matters in college football. These legacy coaches like the Nick Sabans and so on and so forth, they care whether they cover the spread or not. Believe me, they do. Whereas in the NFL, these coaches, they don't care about covering the spread. They care about winning the game. But when you know, when you're going into a season and you know that you are expected to win every single game, all of a sudden, now that you're already expected to win every game, now your new goal is covering every spread. So spreads matter in football. Let me get into this UCF-Louisville game. UCF against the spread in their last six games, 4-2. At home straight up in their last eight games, 8-0. They are a powerhouse in what's called the bounce house because of the way the stadium moves so much. When the students jump up and down, they actually call it the bounce house. It has one of the highest bounce rates of any stadium. It's one of the loudest stadiums. And their home field advantage is lights out.
You have this is UCF?
Yeah.
UCF.
With the bounce house?
With the bounce house, yes.
My kid will love that. I know what we're doing this weekend.
When I say bounce house, that's what their arena, their stadium is called.
No, I get it, but I'll just tell her we're going to a bounce house and give her a hot dog, and she'll be all right.
There you go. So Louisville, they really haven't been the same since Bobby Petrino left, since Lamar Jackson was there. Just not the same team. They're 2-5 against the spread in their last seven. They're 2-9 straight up in their last 11 road games. They do not travel well. Yes, they did beat UCF last year, but UCF started their year off very rocky last year, and they closed it strong versus Louisville, who just fell apart last year. So I'm looking at UCF, and this is another example of buying the points. UCF just beat South Carolina State 56-10. Gus Malzahn, their head coach, he's a more experienced coach than Louisville's coach. I think he's going to be taking this team back to their glory days from a couple years ago. This is a team that's getting a lot of recruits. Louisville is not. I'm looking at Malik Cunningham for Louisville. That's their bright spot. He's their bright spot for the whole team. But besides him, I don't see much else happening there. I'm looking at UCF's quarterback, Rhys Plumlee. I don't even know if I'm saying that correct, and I'll get into players in a second here. But Rhys Plumlee for UCF, he's actually, with his one game, he's tied for ninth in QBR with his numbers that he put up. So he looks great. Gus Malzahn has a lot of experience at head coach. This UCF team covers spreads, but even more so, they cover spreads and they win at home. The line started off at 5.5. It's teetering to 6.5. So this is important. In college football, if you see a line starting at 5.5, moving to 6.5, that's a good sign. Move the line back to 5.5 from 6.5. What if UCF wins the game by 6? Then you play 6.5 and you lose. It's stupid. 5.5 is a safe, smart line. You only lay 130 juice to do so. Play UCF 5.5. UCF minus 5.5.
How much can you buy the spread down? How much can you buy the points down?
Good question. So I personally have a rule. I try not to buy more than 1.5 points. You're generally paying anywhere between 10 and 20% on each half a point, depending on if it's a key line. So to move a line from 6.5 to 5.5, if you're betting, let's say $100, you're going to have to lay 130 to win back 100 versus if you were betting it straight up, you'd be laying 110 to win back 100. So moving it from 6.5 to 5.5, you're paying 20 cents on the dollar. I believe it's worth it. The data also backs it up. Now, there are handicappers out there that will argue with me about this.
Oh, don't use that word. That's not a good word, handicappers. You don't like that word.
That's why they're handicappers. But if you look at my 2021, and I say 2021 because it's a complete year. If you look at my complete year in 2021, you go to my YouTube video, because I have a saying, buy the hook, buy the hook, buy the hook. And that's basically buying the hook is buying the half a point, but we buy the points and we still are profitable because we know the situations to do it. I'm going to dig into my next game if you're cool with that, AJ.
Keep going.
Alabama, Texas. All right.
So let me stop you for 1 second. There's one thing I know. Alabama's good, right?
Go Waves
or something.
Roll Tide.
That was close. All right.
Wow, you really are a college football guy, AJ. I love it. So I'm going to do college football on your show every week if you don't mind.
There you go. Let's put your show on our channel and you can run your own show doing it.
There you go. Alabama is the best team in college football notoriously for the last 10 or 15 years. They have the best head coach, Nick Saban, very well-known guy. Their program's well-known. Last year against the spread, they went 7-6. Not great. Now, they still went to the national championship game. If you followed my channel last year, early in the season, I predicted Georgia to win it all. I predicted Georgia to play Alabama in the national championship game. And before the national championship game, I did a game breakdown where I predicted Georgia was going to cover that spread. So I had it on point last year. Now, real quick, I think it's going to be Alabama and Georgia again this year. Bold statement early on, but that's just my opinion. That being said, last year, everybody was laughing at Nick Saban because he said this was a rebuilding year for us. Now, think about this. The guys went to the national championship game and lost, and the head coach said this was a rebuilding year for us. Cocky, right? I think so. But guess what? I believe it. The year before last, they went 8-2 against the spread. Last year, they went 7-6 against the spread. Think about this for a second. This year, if last year is a rebuilding year, he knows something. They're gonna kick ass this year. So they opened up as 19-point favorites. They're around 20-point favorites against the Aggies. They are notoriously, first of all, 60% against the spread over the last decade, which is always a safe bet. They beat Utah State last week 55-0, which was the biggest margin of victory for a week one game in Nick Saban's career. So they mean business this year. Texas, on the other hand, 0-5 against the spread as underdogs, 2-6 against the spread in their last six games overall. So these are numbers where I look at, and Alabama has the favorite for the Heisman Trophy, Bryce Young. I'm going with Alabama all day. This is another one. If you have this at 21 or you have it at 20.5, move it down to 19.5. It's safe. It's the right thing to do. But Bryce Young, Heisman Trophy winner, most likely, unless something crazy happens, he's going to take care of it. Now, the one bright.
Are you throwing this? Because I've seen other guys do this. They say the absolute lock of the freaking decade on planet Earth. Is that this game or no? This is just you really like this game, but it's not.
In my office, if one of my consultants say the word lock, I suspend them for a day. There's no such thing as a lock, but I see where you're coming from. I like Bama. Of these five games I'm about to break down, they're not my favorite, but I like them. I think it's a strong play. They cover spreads. I mean, that's what they do.
So you say the horns will get hooked, in other words.
I think the horns are going to get hooked. I think, like I said, the bright spot for Texas is their quarterback, and they have the receiver. They have Bijan Robinson. So they have a little bit of bright spot action. Quinn Ewers is a lot of people think he's a sleeper for the Heisman. If Quinn Ewers, and I'm going to make this statement, if Quinn Ewers shows out in this Texas-Alabama game, it could change the landscape and it could cause Texas to cover the spread, but Alabama's going to win the game, but I think they're going to cover the spread as well. Moving right into UNC, Georgia State. Did anyone see the UNC game last week? UNC, Appalachian State?
Yeah. It's like, pretty, yeah, even though I'm like slightly closer to Duke than I am UNC, but yeah, we're all like within the triangle regardless. So.
Okay. Yeah. The UNC game last week, it was 63-61. It was an absolutely insane game. But UNC gave up 40 points in one quarter in that game. Their defense is suspect. They're playing Georgia State. Georgia State's 7-2 against the spread in the last nine. They're 4-1 straight up in the last five. UNC's 3-7 against the spread in their last 10. Now, the reason I talk about these trends don't matter as much in the NFL, but they matter in college football. College football has a tendency of history repeating itself. That's why I love betting it. But yeah, anytime you see a defense give up 40 points in one quarter, you got to be careful. Georgia State, last year, they started off a little slow, but they just crushed at the end. They covered a bunch of spreads. I think they covered their last five or six spreads of the year. They coming right into it, and they're going to do it again. So I'm looking at Georgia State, same thing. They're +7. If you have them at +6.5, buy it to +7.5. I know I sound like a broken record, but that's important in college football because if Georgia State loses by 7, you win at 7.5. I had this, and I'm going to talk about FanDuel real quick. I hope we don't get sued for saying this, but I hate FanDuel. There's a lot of legal sports books coming out right now. FanDuel sets it up for the players to lose. They don't let you buy points. You have to play alternative lines, which makes it very difficult. In baseball, my favorite baseball plays are -0.5 run in the first half or +0.5 run in the first half. FanDuel doesn't give those out for the most part. I had a client this week, two games that I gave him. Cincinnati, +7.5. He could only get it at 6.5, so he didn't play it. Good thing he didn't because he would have lost. And then a first five innings baseball game that he could only play at first five innings -1.5 run. Bottom line is stay away from FanDuel. If you have other options in your state where sports betting is legal and you're using one of, you know, BetMGM, DraftKings, whatever the case may be, FanDuel is putting players at a serious disadvantage. So that's free advice that anyone that's watching. I don't want FanDuel to come after me for defamation, but their lines are just not fair. And it's not something I like to see because this, at the end of the day, this is people's money on the line.
Hey, F FanDuel.
Two more games. We got Mississippi State versus Arizona. Mississippi State 6-2 against the spread in their last eight. 6-1 against the spread on the road in the last seven. And in week two, 6-0 against the spread. So why does week two matter? The reason why week two matters is Mississippi State is an SEC team. And one thing I love to bet are SEC teams playing out of their conference early in the season. They tend to crush. I mean, the SEC is just the best conference, college football, no questions asked. They tend to crush whoever they're playing out of the conference. Now, don't get me wrong. Mississippi State, as far as within the SEC, they're more at the bottom tier. But when they come out of their conference and play out of conference teams, they do well. On the other side of the ball, Arizona, they are 5-2 against the spread in their last seven. That's a great thing. But guess what? That's against their division, early in or their conference. Early in the season, they lack. They're 1-4 against the spread in September. They're 0-5 against the spread in week two. So once again, why does week two matter? Because Arizona is playing out-of-conference teams in these early weeks because that's how the matchups come down, and they're getting crushed. Worst for Arizona in their last 20 games overall, they're 2-18. This is a team in Mississippi State that's favored here by 11 right now. Once again, buy it down to 10, -10. Buy it down to 9.5 if you can. Because they win by 10, you want to be a winner, not a push, right? You know, and another thing with Mississippi State is they have Will Rogers returning. So So one thing with college football is I like to look for these big-time key players that were doing well the year before. Once again, history repeats itself with college football. You got a great quarterback doing well the year before, and he's coming back. There's no reason not to ride him. So Mississippi State minus 9.5, guys. Maybe AJ will put all my picks up here on the at the end for everyone that's not following to go over. Just
I will. I'll put them in the recap, and they'll be up tomorrow. Podcast everywhere, all the info.
So many people fast forward me, and they just go to the end for that breakdown on my video. So I know that's how it goes, and I don't mind it. Last game is BYU versus Baylor. This is an interesting pick for me. Baylor is doing very well right now. They're 5-1 against the spread in their last six. They're 9-0 in September versus BYU team, who's 3-6 against the spread in their last nine, but 7-1 against the spread against Big 12 opponents. And BYU also does very well in September, 7-0. Now, BYU game, it's a little bit different breakdown. It's my last game, by the way. You have Blake Shapen, who's coming in for Baylor. He's replacing Bohannon, and it's his second career game on the road. I don't know how well he's going to fare. BYU is a fishy, what I call a fishy favorite. BYU is a 3.5-point favorite. A lot of the signs here point to Baylor. Baylor beat them last year 38-24. Why is BYU the favorite? This is one of the situations where you look at a line, and sometimes you got to throw everything else out the window and say, huh, I think the odds makers might know something here. So they're 3-point favorites on a situation like this, guys. I like to go with BYU, but just play it on the money line. Minus 150. So you got to lay 150 to win 100, but all you need them to do is win the game. They could win by 1, 2, 3, 20. It doesn't matter. If you got BYU going into the final minute with down a point, and they score a field goal and win by 2, you don't want to be a loser. You don't want to be on that bad beat column. So if you play it on the money line, you are successful there and you are a winner.
All right, so tell us real quick. Your website is thesportsprofits.com.
Sportsprofits.com.
Your IG.
Sportsprofits_.
Yeah, and your IG, and you know, one way to tell if somebody's legit, just go look at their followers on Instagram. They get 25,000 followers on there, so you know.
So look at our commenters. We have fans that have been following us, just like you guys have fans been following us for years on the YouTube. YouTube is where I put really my heart and soul. You know, the Instagram videos, I don't put the full videos on there. YouTube is really where I want everyone to go. Instagram's great, but YouTube, if you want to follow us and you want to see what we're all about, follow our YouTube for sure. Before you guys kick me off, I want to touch on a couple other things about...
All right, and the YouTube is The Sports Profits on YouTube.
The Sports Profits, yes.
Okay, no underscore. All right.
The link is long, but yeah, it's just The Sports Profits. So sports betting just became legal in different states. In Jersey, it's been legal for 6 years. Certain states, it just became legal in January. Eventually, it's like marijuana. It's going to be legal in every state pretty soon, right?
Yeah, it was legal here for like 20 days.
Yeah, right? But, and then the whole thing horrible. With the Seminole tribe, yeah, it was crazy. I had clients who opened up accounts with the Hard Rock, had money in there, and then boom, they're shut down. They got refunded their money. Hopefully it'll be back soon. That's what I'm hoping for. Yeah. But here's what I wanted to say. Legalization. So legalization, one big thing. This is huge for everybody that's watching. Stay the hell away from parlays. All these sports books are advertising parlays right now because they know that's how, number one, that's what entices people. Oh, you can lay down $5 and win back 500. But at the same time, that's how they make all their money because you can't really make a profit betting parlays. Put it this way. If you have a game, and let's just say it's 50-50, either team can win, it's a flip of a coin, you're going to make double your money on that bet, right? You're going to lay down 100, you're going to win 200. Now, if you have two teams, same thing, 50-50, flip of a coin, probability says you have a 25% chance of winning both games, but parlays only pay out 2.5 to 1. If a two-team parlay paid out 4 to 1, I would bet them every single day. But because they only pay out 2.5 to 1, it's a way of the sports book manipulating the mind of the sports bettor. So my best advice, they're advertising parlays right now. That's going to get cracked down on. Don't bet parlays, guys. Don't be afraid to buy points if you need to. And cash out. So one great thing about legalization that the old school bookies never did, the Costa Rican books never did, is they give you the ability, if you're winning a game and the game's not over, you can actually cash out your bet. You might not make the full amount, but play it safe and cash out. That's the one feature of these new legal sports books that I absolutely love. So I would say take advantage of it. Avoid bad beats. You got a few minutes left in the game. You can make the majority of your bet. Just cash it out. And whatever happens the rest of the game doesn't matter.
Yeah, I want to have you back at some point and talk about in-game or live betting, because when the book came out here, when the Hard Rock sports book came out here for a few weeks, I jumped on. I have this weird gift with basketball. I don't like it, but you can just give me the paper, give me a week, let me follow the trends, and I am just a monster with NBA basketball, and then also with the tournament when it comes around. But what I thought was really cool is back in my day when I started, I used to have to make a phone call up to New York, and you know, everything was in code. You know, this is Nails calling for Cats, give me 30 times on Phoenix, all that sort of stuff. Now you got in-game and this and that, and you can change the lines during the game and for the next 2 minutes what's going to happen. So I'd love to have you back at some point where we can go into that, and you know, there's so much.
One more thing about those old school guys from New York. After seeing what these legal sports books do, yeah, the legal sports books are legal. Yeah, they pay taxes, but guess what? The old school bookies offered better lines, better service, and just a more straight up approach where those guys, they give you a better chance at winning, believe it or not, than these online legal sports books.
Better chance of getting your legs broken too, but that's another story. Ted, thank you. That was awesome.
Absolutely.
I'll hit you up. We'll get you back on. If you want to talk to me about No Filter, you know, just give me a holler. But I appreciate you coming on. You are absolutely awesome. Let me get this for you here. Right. Your big round of applause. All right, that's enough.
Let's applause. See what these games do, and then we'll talk about them next week.
Awesome. Thanks for stopping in. Watch the rest of the show if you don't mind.
I'll be right here.
All right. Awesome. Thanks for coming.
Take care, guys.
Remember, guys, it's the sportsprofits.com, the sportsprofits.com, Sports Profits on YouTube, and sportsprofits_ on Instagram. All right. I am going to roll right along here, co-host Reese, to our next guest and bring him in. Rob was on 2 weeks ago, or actually a week ago. Two shows ago, but a week ago, Rob's a big Mets fan. He went to Old Timers Day. I kind of tricked them and hoodwinked some people to come on. Hey, buddy. We're doing good. I was just telling them, you know, I sort of kind of tricked you to come on last week, say talk about Old Timers Day, but I knew that I was going to blindside you guys with Lenny Dykstra. How cool was that having Lenny on?
Oh, wow. That was great. What a surprise that was.
Yeah, now Lenny is super cool. I thought he was great on the show, and Lenny's agreed to come back. You know, if we want him back in the future, so we'll definitely do that. But so, as a big Mets fan, let's start with last week's news before we talk about this week's news. And I also have, and I see him. He's in the knocker room. I'll get to you in a minute. Guy in the knocker room is another Mets fan in there. But go ahead on Old Timers Day. What was what you so you were there? It's the first one in 30 almost years.
Yeah.
What was the
first one that Mets in 94.
Okay.
94 was the last year that the Mets had an Old Timers Day, and this was the first Old Timers Day I ever went to, and it was wonderful. There were a lot of players from all eras of Mets were there. I think probably the biggest surprise was seeing John Stearns. A lot of people remember him.
He looks sick. What's wrong with him? Is he sick? I saw a
picture.
Yeah,
he has stage 4 cancer.
I didn't know that.
And he's not doing very well. And
he didn't look good. I saw the pictures.
You know, I found out a couple months ago.
Dead.
Yeah, I found out a couple months ago. And, you know, it was a shock to me, but I'm just glad that he was able to make it there. I was actually was over by the left field entrance on old before the festivities began, and he was he just arrived out of the bus because there were a couple of Mets players that were coming in like on the red carpet. It was like the red carpet ceremony. So I was kind of there on the side taking video of it, and I got some footage of him as he was coming around the bend heading towards the entrance, which was really great. You know, it was nice to see him. I also saw Todd Pratt, Mike Piazza, going back before my time. Ron Swoboda was also on that bus. He was there. Dennis Cook was another former Philly pitcher, later played for the Mets. So it was nice.
Did you interact with anybody?
Nice.
Were you able to interact?
And then later on. No, unfortunately, no. But it was great to see our friend Penny there. We did a little shout out for Lenny because, you know, Lenny, unfortunately, wasn't able to make it. Because there's a certain reason why, we all know why,
yeah.
But we decided to let him know that we were on his side and giving him some moral support.
For anyone that didn't see last week's show with Lenny, so Lenny Dykstra was not invited back to Alzheimer's Day, and Lenny Dykstra was a huge part of that 86 World Series team. Lenny's yeah. had ups and his downs, but you know, who hasn't in life? But Lenny kept saying on Twitter, look, it'll come out. It's not what you think. And we had some real audio and technical problems on last week's show, and I had a horrible time hearing Lenny. I couldn't hear anything he said until I watched it back on the replay. But what Lenny said, the reason why he did go to Old Timers Day was he said that he banged Steve Cohen's daughter and did her pretty badly in such a way that he didn't get invited to Old Timers Day. So I wish I would have heard that, because that gold right there. I mean, we could have taken that, and he did the first place he ever brought it up. Yeah. Technical
right.
difficulty. So let me ask you, did they play an actual game? Like an Old Timers
yeah, game? They did. I have the footage of it. I have like bits and pieces of it I was able to record there.
Cool. Hold on one second. While you're telling this story, I'm just going to click on this other Mets fan that wants to come on, so he'll pop on in a minute. Go ahead. Tell me about the game.
Okay. They pitched it for about 3 innings, and it was like they had one of the oldest players on the ad there, Steve Dillon. He played with them, I think, from like the first season, I think, before they even went to Shea. He was like close to 80 years old, and he was pitching, and he was throwing strikes, so that was pretty fun to see. You had Todd Pratt and Mike Piazza. You had Dennis Cook pitching to Mike Piazza at one point. You had Kevin Elster playing. You had there was a couple of them there. A lot of the more like younger players, I guess, from like the 2000 team. Even though personally, I'm more partial to like the 86 team and up until like the early 90s.
All right.
It was great.
David Wright there?
A lot of the play.
Was David Wright there? Because I didn't see anything about David Wright.
No, he wasn't there. And his excuse was that he felt he was too young to be a part of Old Timers Day. That was the big thing that they were saying was the reason why he wasn't able to make it. And then, you know.
That is an all-time Met fan right there. Mr. Met, look at you.
Or in this case, Mr. Mutt, I guess.
Yeah, as we used to call the Mutt.
Oh, my goodness. Rob, you remember.
Never missed an opening day for the Mets up until 1994 when I moved to California.
Well, we'll just go ahead and give your identity away, Mr. Met. But okay. And that's when they probably started winning opening days in 1994, because that's when they started getting good with Hubie, and Straw came up, and Gooden was coming up then, and actually be back, because like the news. I mean, how were you this morning, Rob, when you heard the first of all, you wake up and you're tied for first place? So that's got to be like a
Well, the thing is, Mets Twitter was already talking about apocalypse. The sky was falling, you know, was like the end was coming. And then they're all like, you know, they're all getting suicidal on Twitter. And now tonight, they're winning two doubleheaders as I'm looking at the game right now. They're
winning nothing right
they
now.
Won the last game. Now they're winning this one. Now all of a sudden, it's like everything that you heard this morning is like null and void. Now we're back to the same old, oh, cue the trumpets, bah, 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 and, you know, we're going to go all the way. On because earlier today, they were like, oh, we're not even going to make the playoffs. We're not even going to make the wild card. It was ridiculous.
Well, you're guaranteed to make the playoffs. You're too far ahead of the wild card teams. But yeah. If the Mets end up being the number one wild card team, that's a
it's done.
That could be. And here's why. And look, you're a Mets fan. I'm a Phillies fan. We all know that. And you've had our number all season long. But all that means is we're due. We are due to beat you. And if you don't have Mad Max, or if he ain't at 100%, because Mad Max is good, but he is no Curt Schilling when it comes to big game, bloody sock, suck it up, I'll throw three days in a row, pitch out of the pen. And DeGrom, the guy's the best pitcher possibly ever when he's healthy. Yeah. Problem is, he's only healthy like 6 weeks a season.
Yeah, right. So, well, right now he's doing good, but you know I don't know what's going to happen. You know, down the stretch, even after the season's over, you never know. It's like our pitching's been kind of like iffy for a while now.
Yeah, but I mean, you held it together. But does it sink in? And I'm asking this: does it sink in at one point where it's like, oh, this is happening to us again?
Yeah, but it seems like. Around this time, we start to kind of like falter a little bit. I mean, I was watching a couple nights ago, because I like to watch the old Met games, and I was watching from September of 1990. They were in a dead heat tie for first place with the Pittsburgh Pirates. And at that time, the Pirates were a really red-hot team. And they were, I think, a half a game out of first, one game out of first with them. In early September of 1990, they lose a doubleheader to the Pirates, and then the following week, like maybe like 9 days later, they're back in the fold again. They beat the Pirates, and you know it was a close race at that point, but the Mets didn't go all the way. So I think the Reds won the World Series that year. I think, if I'm not mistaken, 1990. I don't remember.
Well, this is gonna be good coming down to the wire, and with this new wild card format right here. So even if the Mets will at least get the number one wild card. So they'll either be at home for three games against Philly or San Diego, who really, I don't get the hype with San Diego. They don't scare me at all. I really don't. They just don't have
really know about
act
them.
Together.
I don't really follow them.
The team that I would worry about the most is St. Louis, because they're flying so under the radar and they are bad.
Yeah.
I mean, in a good way, they are bad.
Plus they're trying to go out with trying to let Albert get one more playoff run for his retirement.
Yeah, and when we want him to, I want him to get 700 is what I want. So, Rob, I apologize that you didn't get to be on more last week with Lenny, but it was Lenny. You know, and I'm glad that you came back on. You have an open door anytime you want to come on. Just let me know, especially when we get close to playoffs. I'd love to have you on talking playoffs, and even if we got to go head to head, maybe a pie in the face type of bet or something like that. If the Phillies go up against the Mets,
We have a question.
Okay. Good.
And ironically enough, it's from my good buddy Captain Ron. He wants to know. He wants to ask Chef Tom. He does know he can remove that bag for at least a few weeks, right?
Yeah. You got to keep that bag on until the Mets are eliminated from the playoffs. So. And Captain Ron is coming up momentarily to close out the show. So, but anyway, Rob, communicate with me offline, communicate with me online, either way. Yeah. You're a good guy. I'm glad I got to know you a little bit. Let's stay in touch. And like I said, anytime you want to come on, spread the word about the show. Please come back and watch. And everything. I don't know if you saw the Lenny video exploded in the last couple of days on our YouTube channel. So people are watching it and digging it. So. Yeah, we'll be back. So, all right, man. Thanks for stopping in. Baghead,
right,
Mets
no
fan.
Problem. Take care.
All right, have a good night.
Take care, guys.
Baghead, thanks.
See you later, Rob.
All right. And last but not least, all right, and we get to the end of the show that fast. And I had stuff. I actually had a spot. We have a sponsor, and I didn't get to the spot. So let me do that real fast before I bring the captain on, okay? Because we got to pay the bills here, kind of. Yeah.
That'd be digital support.
What's that? You're paying the bills?
Yeah.
Yeah, this will, I don't know what the heck this will pay for, but it's a start, and that's what we're doing. But Digital Lux 22, if you're a small business owner, a large business owner, if you're a podcaster, social media influencer, a network marketer, if you just want to build your online presence, you've got two options. You can try to do it yourself, or you can hire a professional. The problem with doing it yourself is how do you do it? What is SEO? Google changes constantly. Facebook changes their algorithms constantly. Twitter shadow bans anybody for everything all the time. How do you get a trending video on TikTok? There's a lot of companies out there that'll tell you for $29, we will get you on page one of Google and we'll get you showing up in all the algorithms. Don't get scammed, okay? Hire a legit digital marketing company. I know the people at Digital Lux 22. I've worked with Digital Lux 22. I've worked with companies that have worked with them. They can build your Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, YouTube, TikTok, website, and they can get you to the top rank on Google. So that website is Digital Lux 22. It is absolutely impossible. Take it from me. I've been in business for 30 years. It is impossible to get to the top of Google and stay there on your own. Hire a professional. If you mention, and their website is Digital Lux with two L's. So digital with the L, Lux with the L, the number 22.com. Mention the Bleacher Brothers and you get a 40% introductory package for the first 3 months. So 40% discount on any sort of services. They do it all. They do a la carte, whatever you need. Digital Lux 22 can help you out. And that's pretty cool, man. I read a live commercial. How was that? Huh?
And like Dunkin' Dad said, trust approves. And Sports Profit said, yeah.
What did Dunkin' say?
Dunkin' Dad said, trust the proves. And then yeah. Sports Profits all said, same with sports betting. Don't do it on your own.
Oh, absolutely. If you knew what I've done in my lifetime, sports betting on my own, that wasn't basketball, you would get sick. So I don't even want to get into that. So anyway, let's round this thing out. NFL starts tomorrow. Okay. There is a NFL kickoff show on our channel tomorrow that does not have me as the host. I may stop on very early tomorrow, but there's one thing more important than that show to me tomorrow. It's my wife's birthday. So my wife gets me tomorrow. I will get you guys rolling in the beginning, but
then, I already spoke my piece as far as my sister goes. So no, I am literally saying if he messes up tomorrow, it ain't my fault. It ain't my fault, sis. I'm just letting you know. It ain't my fault.
Hey, Ron, if you can turn yourself down at all on your mic, because you're coming in hot.
Of course I come in hot. That's what I do.
I know that you do, but you're coming in crazy hot right now. And the way I'm still figuring this board out, but I was.
Is it better? Is that better?
Yeah, I think that is a little bit better. Okay. But yes. When Ted came on, initially he was low, and I was actually able to manipulate his volume, which was really cool, and bring him up. So to Dow to me, huh?
Very. Look at you become a tech savvy. Look at you become a tech savvy.
Wait until I load this up with 65 different sound bites. Oh, it's going to be on. But anyway, for those of you who don't know, Ron, the Captain Johnson, the uglier dude that just popped up on the other side. Reese is the pretty boy of the two. You got the brains and then you got the pretty boy, I guess, or the mouth and the pretty boy. Reese is the pretty boy, Ron is the mouth. Let me tell you a little bit about Ron real fast before I let him give us a glimpse into tomorrow's show. This dude was podcasting before podcasting existed. He was on Facebook the first day you could go live talking sports. And I mean all sports. This guy knows wrestling. He knows MMA. He knows baseball. He knows football. He knows basketball. I think he knows figure skating. You name it, this dude does it, okay? The other thing is this. He was Stephen A. Smith before Stephen A. Smith even existed. This guy is loud. This guy is in your face. This guy is the most passionate mofo that I ever met talking sports. And we picked him.
I had a beer, I'd drink to that.
We picked him for the NFL. That's why I contacted Ted and said, hey, can we talk college? Because I got somebody else doing NFL tomorrow. And he's got a whole NFL hype show tomorrow. His show is The Last Call. I know it's ridiculous to have a show named The Last Call in the middle of the day, but he's on at 3 p.m. Eastern time tomorrow because he wants to come on before the football game and go as close to kickoff as possible. Reese is going to be sidekicking with him tomorrow. Ron, what can we expect tomorrow when The Last Call returns and makes its debut, its real debut on No Filter Network? Because I've seen you filtered. What are you going to look like unfiltered?
I'll put it like this. The shit is definitely going to be hitting the fan a lot tomorrow. I'm going to answer. I'm actually going to take a moment. I'm going to answer Duncan Dad's question there. The L, I feel like, would hurt the Bills more because everybody and their mama over the last few days, I've been watching the dirt sheets and watching these so-called experts. But the fact is they all have picked that the Bills are not only going to finish the season as Super Bowl champs, but they actually said that they're going to be the ones that's going to dethrone. They don't even have them playing the Rams except for Kurt Warner. I think he's the only one that actually has the Rams playing in that Super Bowl.
Can I tell that one real quick?
But I'm just trying to figure out my head.
All right, don't give us your picks. Just tell us what to expect tomorrow.
I'm not making any picks yet because I've already pretty much gave Reese. Reese, I sat here and told you a long time ago.
Duncan Dad has no credibility. He said that Albert Pujols would not get to 500-700 home runs. He said Judge. I was going to say A-Rod. Judge wouldn't get to 60, and Judge is going to be at 60 by tomorrow. So Duncan
Dad. I kind of figured like that would be the case, right? Too. And honestly, Pujols, the way he's hitting,
Can I tell you a story real quick when we talked about this?
Yes, please, if you could. By the way,
everybody, if you want to know how unfiltered Ron's going to be, man, y'all know he is a diehard Rams fan. When I showed him the pics of like how everybody was gonna look for preseason Super Bowl favorites, I saw Kurt Warner's pick. And that way he said the Bills were going to beat the Rams. Yes, the Rams, the team that Kurt Warner actually won a Super Bowl with. Oh Lord Jesus. I thought this man was going to go to jail.
Will you guys be giving your Super Bowl picks and all your division picks on the show tomorrow?
I feel like when just that time frame, I feel like we'll probably save those for maybe post game, like possibly Sunday or Monday, because I want to focus completely on just the opening of week one, because we got a big college football weekend coming up. We got a big NFL week coming up. All the shit that's hitting the fan with fan and sports, entertainment, professional wrestling, and everything else. The reason why I'm sitting here looking like I am right now is because of the fact that these are going to be the reasons of why it's called The Last Call. And these are the reasons of why Reese was basically saying what he was saying. To put it as nicely as possible, I am going to basically be probably going to say give my Super Bowl picks because, quite frankly, I said last year that the Bills weren't going to make the Super Bowl. I said they weren't going to make it. I said somebody was going, a dark horse was going to show up to the Super Bowl last year. We had two. We had the Bengals and we had the Rams. The Rams were due. The Bengals were due. Fact is that if they're expecting the Bills to finally exercise their demons and finally get that 1-1-4,
Both of those teams are going to bounce like a bouncy ball dropped off the Empire State Building. Neither one of them are making it back to the Super Bowl. The Rams probably won't even make the playoffs. And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to give you the Super Bowl winner. The Jimmy G-led San Francisco 49ers. Laugh at me now. We got to think of a wager. It doesn't make a difference. I'll wait weeks, but we're going to come up with something good, me and you.
Oh, trust me. I pretty much already have a wager in my head. Reese, go ahead.
I'll make another guarantee of who it will not be. It won't be the Cardinals. Yeah.
Man, nobody cares about the Cardinals. Well, yeah, unless you're talking about the St. Louis Cardinals.
Because I'll tell you this right
now.
Salty. Yeah, because for everybody that's thinking we're going to have 3 straight years of somebody playing a Super Bowl in their house, let me stop you right there. It ain't happening.
And no, San Francisco. Well, San Francisco's not going to win Super Bowl either.
Against Tom Brady. How cool is that going to be? But again, we are at the end, literally time wise. So give me a real quick, give me 60 seconds of, hey, this is what you're going to get tomorrow. If you skip out of work early, if you forget about your kid and just leave her at school in aftercare and tune into the show.
One sense, I'll actually agree with that. So I'll put it like this, folks. I know how much we're all waiting for Friday because it's one step closer to the weekend. But the fact remains, this is opening night. This is the opening night of the NFL season. We have been waiting for it, been clamoring for it. We are going to get you guys pumped up and set up. If you basically have never seen us in action, get y'all asses in here because for once, the sensors, they're gone. The finger wags, they're broken. We are going to go as hard as we can. So hard, in fact, that I'm almost damn sure certain there's going to be a few housewives that are literally going to be having cigarettes when it's over. Come watch us. Come join us. Let's have some fun.
All right, guys. You guys are on at 3 o'clock. So you guys are doing every Wednesday at 3 to 5 Eastern time. Am I right?
Thursday.
That's right. I'm on Wednesday. The freaking holiday on Monday has got me all screwed up. And then my dad hurt Ron, and I got stuck behind a school. You don't even know my day.
We will blame Tony Bruno for it, who actually is reminding us all that Into the Night will be Friday nights at 7 p.m. Eastern. So please go support your boy. Support Tony Bruno. Support The Last Call.
I did it in the beginning, and I'm doing it again. I want to thank everybody that watched tonight for what I'm seeing that you can't see. It looks like we have our biggest crowd yet on live. Yeah, Duncan Dad is always there. Thank you participating in the Pat into the chat. Tony Bruno, awesome. Thank you, Tony. I really appreciate you coming on tonight. Chef Tom, everybody from Sports Profits.
We have a
did not get on the chat. I want to thank Rob for coming on again tonight. I want to thank Digital Lux for the sponsor. Ted Brooks gave us awesome, fantastic information tonight.
Of course, one more quarter at 12:15 Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays.
Absolutely. We have Into the Nightcap also on Fridays after Tony Bruno. So
Stephen Luker does his retro show. Thank you, Digital Lux. Thank you, No Filter. I will be back on Wednesday. That's my day. You guys go Thursday. Wednesday next week, I'll be back same time. And next week, I got a really cool guest also. Got a guy by the name of Frank Savannah. He was a boxer in the early 90s, a professional boxer. He was at one point 18-0, and I know he was ranked, I believe, middleweight. The guy's become a very good friend of mine, so we're going to talk about his career, what it was like growing up to be a boxer, what its life is like after boxing, and we are going to preview the biggest fight of the year, Triple G and Canelo 3. Triple G was ripped off on the first fight. Triple G was ripped off on the second fight. Triple G is going to rip Canelo's head off on the third fight. So anyway, everybody, that's it. Thank you for coming. We will see you guys next week. I got to come out with a good outro, and I didn't get to a lot of my sound effects. Anyway.
You need an outro?
Yeah, I need an outro. You should have
Reese, do you want to help him out?
I can watch. Anyway, guys, that's it. I'm out. Have a good night. I got to go home. I slept 3 hours in the past 2 days. Thank you. Good night, Reese. Thanks for coming on, buddy. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Jason.
All right.